know from scripture and early church history and tradition, Barnabas was a Jew from Cyprus. Not one of the original 12, possibly one of the 70 that was sent out as reported in Luke. And when he became a Christian and part of the church, some had said of his activities, it was for keeps. He sold his land and gave it to the company of those who believed, to the apostles. Barnabas discovered Paul, brought him into the Christian community, becoming very close friends and traveling partners. They went on missionary journeys together while still holding secular employment. Barnabas was also a friend of Mark the evangelist, and they too would work together. Mark and Barnabas went to Cyprus, where Barnabas is revered as the founder of the church in Cyprus. Barnabas continued his missionary journeys as reported by Paul until he was martyred in 61. Barnabas is an example and a reminder of what it means to follow Jesus and to go out and to preach, to heal, to invite people to come and see this Jesus, to counsel and to forgive and to welcome those in need of God's healing power. So that's just a stage and what I want to kick off with as we think about this night, the celebration of a new ministry. And on the surface, we think of this to be all about Father Kevin. This is his night. But it really is about much, much more. It's about you. About you all. It's about you and your priest. Together. Here's what I mean. Pay attention to the service. You may remember the first part of the service. The first words spoken in the service were not from the bishop. They were not from Kevin. They were from the wardens, the lay people, those whom you elected to represent you. That is very significant to me, that at the very beginning, we began the service with a word and a representative or representatives from the congregation. And then, remember, I asked you all very shortly, would you support him and uphold him? And you said, we will. You all have a part in this service at the very beginning. And you, members of this congregation, join in ministry by giving to Father Kevin symbols of the ministry in this place. Shortly after the presentation of these different signs, there is a prayer Father Kevin will read in your midst. It is a very powerful prayer, and I ask that you listen very carefully as you pray that with him. I want to say just a few short words about your role. And I'm sure you're wondering, when are you going to preach about the rector? What are you going to preach about Kevin? Isn't that what this is about? As I said at the beginning, no, it's not about Kevin. It's about you and Kevin together. Your role as a teacher. That sounds strange, doesn't it? He's supposed to be the teacher. That's what we prayed for, wasn't it? Here's what I mean. Shortly after arriving at St. Francis Episcopal Church in Victoria, Texas, I was picked up early one Saturday morning to go. I was picked up by a group of laypersons, and we were to go to Corpus Christi for a conference on stewardship. But I'd heard that word stewardship in seminary, I think. I didn't know you did a conference on it. So it was new to me. And they actually had a conference on stewardship. And it during that time, on that weekend, at that conference and later, that those lay people at St. Francis taught me about stewardship. They taught me about how to be a priest. They taught me how to be an administrator. They taught me so much. You all have a role as a teacher, a partner in learning. Over my 32 years as rector in three different congregations, the laity were my professors, my teachers, my mentors, my guides. As a bishop now for over 13 years, I'm still educated by God's lay people, women, men, and young people. As Kevin knows, initially some of the best teachers and mentors are the parish secretaries. And in my case, in those three congregations, they were the parish secretaries and the sextons. In McAllen, when I was in the Diocese of West Texas down the valley, I had a wonderful sexton named Jose Bittencourt. And he was invaluable to me because he would say, if Mrs. So-and-so tells you she's going to do something, don't believe her. She won't do it. A great source of knowledge. You all have that. You're the teachers. You're the professors. You're the mentors. Now, the next thing I want to talk about is very briefly is vision. The old model of the church seemed to revolve around that fundamental canonical rule. The Father knows best. And I think you all are much more familiar with that in this diocese than a lot of other dioceses. And that concept dies and is dying a slow death among the laity and even a slower death among some clergy. We are partners. We are partners in ministry as our services emphasize, and partners work together. Partners talk. They disagree. They argue. They share dreams and visions. Dare to dream together. Laity, vestry, priest. Do not let your visioning be cut short by your material or personal concerns before you can ever see what might happen. How many vestries have had an idea and then they were put off because they thought, oh, this might cost more money than we might have. Among my long list of failures and shortcomings as a clergy person was my first attempt at a vestry retreat. Now, you have to remember, this was in the early 70s. No, I mean like 1970. I was new and at this congregation, but the idea of a vestry retreat in those days was new and novel. It was not done really before in the Episcopal Church that I knew of in my part of the world. And so I, using the old model, I prepared for the vestry retreat with a theme, with questions, and even had answers. And I'm not through yet. I even came up with what the vestry was going to decide and how they were going to follow through and implement it. At least I tried. And then I discovered this secret, this magical tool, asking others to help structure it using the wardens and the executive committees to help put together a vestry retreat or help come and work with an idea. That was a brilliant idea on my part. Of course, after I'd gotten beaten up a few times, I finally came to that. I let those lay leaders lead, and it wonderful. The late William Temple, Archbishop of Canterbury, when he was a diocesan bishop, used to gather his clergy each year for a retreat. He stressed that they were all hirelings, and whether they would ever become true shepherds would depend on them, on their type of relationship that they wanted to have with their people, and on the pastoral relationship their people would allow them to establish. So, you and these faithful members have a joint responsibility, one to the other, priest and laity. You have a joint responsibility. If Kevin is to become something more than a hireling for you in this congregation, you must avoid falling into that trap that some people easily move into. They do something that tends to cancel out a person's ministry. They look upon that person as just filling a job, even though it is a somewhat specialized one. I remember working with a congregation in the Diocese of Texas, in East Texas, and I met with the vestry people on the phone, and they were anxious to get going and get started, and I suggested to them, or I told them, they needed to go through a process of thinking about who they were and kind of what their values were and their goals and what kind of person they wanted. And finally, this lady of mature years told me she thought that was a bunch of and she was really upset about that. And I said, no, you need to do this. It will be good for you. And as she thought that, and they went through that, and finally she said, look, Bishop, we don't have a rector. You send us some names, and we'll hire a new boy. That's what were her words. They wanted a hireling. Well, that's not what they got. And the process worked for them. So, remember your responsibility to each other in moving Kevin from a hireling and helping him become your shepherd, and you become his sheepfold. Along those lines, remember that the more time that passes, and the longer that Kevin is here as a priest, as your priest, the more he will fail you. And during this time, the more he fails you, you all will fail him. And together, you and Kevin will fail the Lord more times than you want to even admit. But just like a family, in families we fail each other. So forgiveness and love will be the ongoing basis for your relationship. For that's the only way which your living together can go on for any number of years, and I hope it will be for many, many years, and still be productive as one of Christ's holy, giving, and serving churches. Whenever a congregation calls a new priest, we say we are led by God's Holy Spirit, and I truly believe that. We do not know what our ministry is going to look like in the months and the years ahead, but we believe that we have arrived at this moment in our life through the grace of God, through the guidance of the Holy Spirit, and that's enough for us to celebrate and move forward. We are a resurrection community where new, different, amazing, transforming things are what we expect to take place here. I believe deep down, there are great opportunities right now and in the future ministry of Christ section in your life. Trust Kevin not only as your spiritual and sacramental leader, but trust yourselves to be a partner with him in ministry in this place. At the end of the induction part that we're going to do in just a moment, I will say, Kevin, that all these signs of the ministry which is mine and yours in this place, what we say and do this night will be signs of the ministry which is Kevin's